1849 to 1925. He was a German mathematician and a mathematics educator. He is known for his work in group theory, complex analysis, non-Euclidean geometries. The geometries what we are learning up to BSc is a Euclidean geometry, but there is another geometries are also there, what are called non-Euclidean geometries. And he also studied on the associations between geometry and group theory. So this is a lecture that connects geometry to group theory. Felix Klein in 1872 started a project entitled Erlangen Program in the University of Erlangen. What are its aims? Its aim is to classify geometries, not geometry, geometries means Euclidean geometry, non-Euclidean geometries, all those geometries by their basic symmetric groups from the perspective group theory. That means you have to study symmetric groups, symmetry groups, not symmetric groups, symmetry groups. This is a new word for you, but you know symmetric groups, you know, but this is about symmetry groups. Symmetry groups is the group of all symmetries of a figure, either in two dimensions or in space, wherever it is. And the talk is limited to symmetry groups. And this work was an influential synthesis of much of the mathematics of that day. It is named after the University of Erlangen where Klein worked. Plane symmetry. There is a space symmetry is also there, but I am restricting my attention to this lecture to plane symmetries. A plane symmetry of a figure F in a plane is a function F that maps F onto F, which preserves the distances. It is a mapping from the plane figure F on to the plane figure F, which preserves the distance. What do you mean by preserves the distance? The distance between two points P and Q is equal to the distance between their images, namely F of P, comma F of Q, for all PQ belongs to F. What do you mean by preserves the distance? It preserves the distance, that is D of distance between P and Q, the points P and Q is equal to the distance between their images, that is F of P and F of Q. This is true for all PQ belongs to F, then F preserves the distance. This is also sometimes called an isometry. We find many symmetries around us in nature. For example, here is a butterfly which has a symmetry. This is the line of symmetry. This is the line of symmetry. And some of the plants where the flowers and their leaves will also possess symmetries. And the symmetries are divided into two categories. The first category is reflective symmetry. That means symmetry due to reflection. Reflection across a line L is a function F that leaves every point of L fixed. So that means for a reflective symmetry, you need the line of symmetry, that is L. And it is a function which leaves every point of F fixed. So F of P is equal to P for all P belongs to L. Here is the line and a line L and F of P is equal to P for all P belongs to L. And it takes any point Q not on L and it maps to F of Q, Q prime, so that this line L is the perpendicular bisector of the line segment joining Q and Q prime. So let's see, Q is a point which is not on L. Its image F of Q, Q prime, and the line segment joining Q and Q prime, and L is the perpendicular bisector of the line segment joining Q and Q prime. So such a thing is called reflection across a line L. A reflection across a line L is also called reflective symmetry, or sometimes called mirror symmetry, with L as the axis of symmetry, sometimes called L as the line of the symmetry. A reflective symmetry is normally denoted by mu. And a demonstration is here. L is the line of symmetry. Look at the animation. The mirror image of this part in L is this. The mirror image of this part in L is this. So that is the meaning of the reflective symmetry. Okay. What is the next category? The next category is a rotational symmetry. That means symmetry which results due to rotation of the figure F. A plane figure has a rotational symmetry if it can be rotated by an angle theta that lies between 0 degrees and 360 degrees about a fixed point, so that the image coincides with its pre-image. So a plane figure is said to have rotational symmetry if it can be rotated by an angle theta that lies between 0 degrees and 360 degrees about a fixed point, so that the image coincides with this pre-image. The fixed point around which the rotation is taking place is called the center of rotation. The angle of rotational symmetry is the smallest angle for which the figure can be rotated to coincide with itself. It is the smallest angle for which the figure can be rotated to coincide with itself. The angle of rotational symmetry is normally denoted by alpha, and the corresponding rotational symmetry to alpha is denoted by rho alpha. Alpha is the angle of rotational symmetry, and rho alpha is the rotational symmetry corresponding to alpha. The order of the rotational symmetry is the number of times the figure coincides with itself as it rotates through 0 degrees to 360 degrees. So when it rotates 0 degrees to 360 degrees, the number of times the figure coincides with itself is defined as the order of rotational symmetry. Rotational symmetries of a figure F. Here is a figure F. Okay. The center of this is the vertex 3. The vertex 3. Suppose I rotate by 90 degrees. So these vertices in blue are called the transformed ones. That means no rotation is there now. 1 is mapped to 1, 2 is mapped to 2, 3 is mapped to 3. It's an identity mapping. But suppose I rotate by 90 degrees clockwise. Is it a symmetry? No. Why? Because it is not coinciding with itself. Therefore, I'll go back and now I will rotate through 180 degrees. What is happening? The figure is coinciding with itself. Therefore, it is a rotational symmetry corresponding to the angle alpha that is equal to 180 degrees. So therefore, rho alpha can be defined. So the rho alpha will be what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 is mapped to, 1 is mapped to 5, 2 is mapped to 9, 3 is mapped to 3, 4 is mapped to 7, 5 is mapped to 1, 6 is mapped to 2, and 7 is mapped to 4. That was a bijection, which is a permutation from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. The block 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 are the original figure. And the blue vertices are the transformed ones. So alpha is equal to the angle of rotational symmetry. That is the smallest angle for which figure can be rotated to coincide with itself. That is 180 degrees. The order of rotational symmetry is one time I have done through 180. Through once again I do it, that is 360 degrees. If I do it, what happens? The number of times the figure coincides with itself as its rotation, it rotates through 360 degrees. So second time. So therefore, first time when it is 180 degrees, when it is coming to 360, second time. Therefore, the order of rotational symmetry is 2. Therefore, these rotations form a group under the composition of mappings, and rho square is identity. Okay. So now, symmetry group. Don't get confused by two words. One is symmetry group and the other is symmetric group on n letters, which is denoted by S suffix n, what you study. But symmetry group, we normally do not study in our class. The symmetry group of a plane figure is the set of all symmetries of the figure under what composition? The composition of maps. Notation. The symmetry group of a plane figure F is denoted by SYM sim bracket F, like this. Note, the set of all permutations of a set A is equal to 1, 2, 3, N, is called symmetric group of degree N and is denoted by SN. The set of all permutations of a set A is equal to 1, 2, 3, N is called symmetric group. Don't get confused between symmetric group and symmetry. So we are talking about symmetry groups. And symmetry groups are subgroups of symmetric groups. Symmetric group of a rectangle. Our figure is rectangle. We will now compute symmetric group of R, where R is the rectangle, and show that it is the Klein's 4 group. We know, we study what is Klein's 4 group. I will show you how the Klein's 4 group was actually discovered. Rotational symmetries of a rectangle. So here is a rectangle. Now, blue 1, 2, 3, 4 is transformed once. No rotation, 0 degrees it is rotated. So it is the identity. So rho naught means the rotational symmetry corresponding to 0 degrees is what? 1, 2, 3, 4, the original in the domain will be transformed into 1, 2, 3, 4 in the blue. Suppose I rotate by 90 degrees. It's not coinciding. It is not rotational symmetry. Therefore, what I do, I'll go back and I will rotate by 180 degrees. Now alpha is what? Alpha is the angle of rotational symmetry, the smallest angle for which the figure can be rotated to coincide with itself is 180 degrees. The corresponding rotational symmetry rho alpha is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. The domain is mapped to 3, 4, 1, 2. The same order you have to write, 3, 4, 1, 2. So what are you getting? Corresponding to a symmetry, you are getting a permutation. You are getting a permutation. What are these elements? These are the elements which are permutations of S4. Sn, n is equal to 4. So now one more 180 degrees, it is coinciding and it gives this one. So therefore, rho 2 alpha is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, and coming to the original 1, 2, 3, 4, which is the rho naught, which is the identity permutation. So the order of rotational symmetry is 2. 2 times, you know, the number of times the figure coincides with itself as it rotates through 360 degrees is 2 times. So what we have is the rotational group, rho alpha, rho 2 alpha, is rho 360, is rho naught. It is a cyclic group generated by rho, where rho is equal to rho alpha, rho square is equal to rho 2 alpha is equal to the identity, where rho is equal to rho alpha, rho square is equal to rho 2 alpha is equal to rho naught. Here, this epsilon is the symbol what we have used for the identity. Throughout this lecture, this symbol epsilon will stand for the identity. What is it? The rotation group is a cyclic group generated by rho whose order is 2. Okay. It is a proper subgroup of S4. Okay. Now we go to the reflective symmetries of a rectangle. So here is two rectangles what I have drawn. And this is, there are two axes of symmetry connecting the midpoints of opposite sides. Suppose 1, 4, 2, 3 opposite sides, midpoints. So 1, 2, 4, 3, I have taken opposite sides and the midpoints are connected and PQ is the axis of symmetry. And this is the other axis of symmetry. This is the other axis of symmetry. So let mu 1 be the reflective symmetry with PQ as the line of symmetry, and see the reflection in them. So that means the vertex V is mapped to 2, the vertex 2 is mapped to 1, the vertex 3 mapped to 4, the vertex 4 is mapped to 3. Therefore, mu 1 corresponds to 1 is mapped to 2, 2 is mapped to 1. 3 is mapped to 4, 4 is mapped to 3. Mu 1 is the reflective symmetry corresponding to the line of symmetry PQ. For the line of symmetry RS, let mu 2 be the reflective symmetry with RS as the line of symmetry. That is this one. So what will be the corresponding permutation? The corresponding permutation is mu 2 is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. The 1 is mapped to 4, 4 is mapped to 1. 1 is mapped to 4, 4 is mapped to 1. Now, 2 is mapped to 3, 3 is mapped to 2. So, 2 goes to 3, 3 goes to 2. So, suppose if I take mu 1 and repeat once again, mu 1 times, that means mu 1 square, what happens? A reflection comes to the identity. So, therefore, mu 1 square is equal to mu 2 square is the identity. And you observe that when we are composing the permutations in the permutation groups, you know, when the permutations are expressed in array notation, how do we compose? Now we compose, and that composition is carried out from right to left, not from left to right to left, going from top to bottom, then again top to bottom. Agreed? Composition of permutations expressed in array notation is carried out right to left by going from top to bottom, then again top to bottom. So I'll multiply further. Mu1 row is equal to mu1 is 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 1, 4, 3. Row 1, 2, 3, 4 mapped to 3, 4, 1, 2. How do we compose them? Now, from right to left, so this is the right and this is the left. 1 goes to 3, 3 goes to 4, therefore 1 goes to 4. 2 goes to 4, 4 goes to 3, 2 goes to 3. 3 goes to 1, 1 goes to 2, 3 goes to 2. 4 goes to 2, 2 goes to 1, 4 goes to 1. That is mu 2. So mu 1 row is mu 2. Now, we will now compute the symmetric group of a rectangle. We have the rotation group of the rectangle is a cyclic group generated by rho, where rho is rho alpha is 1, 2, 3, 4 mapped to 3, 4, 1, 2. And rho square is equal to rho naught is the identity permutation. We have two reflective symmetries, what we have seen, mu 1 and mu 2. And mu 1 square is equal to mu 2 square is equal to identity. And we have already seen in the last slide, mu 1 rho is equal to mu 2. And now I will consider the left coset of the cyclic group generated by rho. That is mu 1 rho, mu 1 bracket rho. That is mu 1 multiplied the composed to the set consisting of epsilon rho, because the cyclic group generated by rho is epsilon rho. and that will be mu1 epsilon, mu1 identity is mu1, mu1 rho is mu1 rho, but mu1 rho is mu2. So it is the set consistent. So that means if you take the left coset of the cyclic group generated by rho by mu1, you will get the reflections. Therefore, your group further rho mu1, rho multiplied by or composed by mu1 is mu2, which is equal to mu1 rho. This is necessary for computing the Kallis table. Now, symmetric group of the rectangle R is given by the group of symmetries of the rectangle R. What are the symmetries? We have rotational symmetries and reflective symmetries. Therefore, the set of all rotational symmetries union the set of all reflective symmetries. That is equal to the rotational symmetries are the cyclic group generated by rho union the reflective symmetries are the mu1, mu2, that is equal to the cyclic group generated by rho union the left coset mu1 rho. So that means this symmetric group of the rectangle R is generated by two elements. One is rho and the other is mu1. So symmetry sim R is the group generated by rho comma mu1. What are the properties? Rho square is equal to mu1 square is equal to identity, and rho mu1 is equal to mu1 rho. And these are called the defining relations of a group. Normally, in a classroom, the teachers may not be teaching the defining relations of group. But the defining relations are very important for writing or computing the Kallis tables. So the order of the symmetric group of R is 4. Why? The cyclic group generated by rho is 2, and these are 2 elements and 4, and it is the Klein's 4 group. Why it is Klein's 4 group? It generated by rho and mu, and rho square is equal to mu1 square is equal to identity. Rho mu1 is equal to mu2. And those are the defining relations of a Klein's 4 group. And what is the speciality of the Klein's 4 group? It is a non-cyclic but abelian group of smallest order. So what is the specialty of the Klein's 4 group? It is a non-cyclic abelian group of smallest order. So that is how the Klein actually invented or discovered the Klein's 4 group. So now we talk about its Kallis table. This is your Kallis table. So epsilon, rho, mu1, mu2 is mu1 rho. So we will write only mu1 rho. Mu1 rho. So rows and column multiply. That is a 4x4 grid you will get, and you have to write down. And now first, it is very easy to write the first row. Why? Epsilon, identity, rho, identity, mu1, identity, mu1 rho. Mu1 rho. So very easily you can write those things. This is the thing. And the first column also you can write. Why? Identity, rho, mu1 rho. So you will get this one, this column. So first row, first column, you can very easily write. Continue. First row is already there. The first column, which we have already seen, but we want the second row with these stars. Be careful here. And this is the same thing what I will be talking about for D3 and D4 also. Now, rho square. Rho square is identity. Here it is identity. Rho mu1 is mu1 rho is mu2. Okay. Rho mu1 rho into mu1 rho. Take the associativity. Rho mu1 rho. What is rho mu1? Mu1 rho. So mu1. Rho square. This is mu1 rho square. Rho square is identity. This is mu1. So therefore, you will get here identity, here mu 1 rho, here mu 1, here it is mu 1, here it is mu 1. So let us see, mu 1 rho, so this has come. So I have filled the second row. So let us see, I will fill up the third row similarly, third row with stars. So mu 1 rho is equal to mu 2. Mu 1 rho only because mu 1 rho is here. And mu 1 square is identity. Mu 1 rho. So mu 1 rho is equal to mu 1 rho. That is equal to mu 1 square rho. Mu 1 square is identity. Identity rho is rho. So here it is mu 1 rho. Here it is identity. Here it is rho. You will get this. So now, I will now fill up the fourth row. So mu 1 rho is mu 1 rho square. Mu 1 rho square is identity, mu 1. So here it is mu 1. Now it is mu 1 rho, mu 1. So mu 1 rho, mu 1. So mu associativity, mu 1 rho, mu 1. Rho mu 1 is mu 1 rho. So therefore mu 1 rho. This will be mu 1 square rho. Mu 1 square is identity. Identity rho, rho. So here you will get rho. The third one. Mu 1 rho is mu 1 rho mu 1. And that is equal to mu 1. Rho mu 1 is mu 1 rho. So mu 1 rho. So mu 1 square rho square. Mu 1 square is identity. Rho square is identity. Identity is identity. So therefore, it is mu 1 at this place rho, at this place epsilon, identity. You will get this kind of thing. Now see, this is 2x2 grid is all rotations. And this 2x2 grid is in all rotations only. And this 2x2 grid is all reflections. This 2x2 is reflections. This is the salient property of the Kallis tables of reflections and rotations, provided you maintain the appropriate order for them. Now, how this is the Kallis table is looking like? This is the Kallis table, and that mu1 rho I will replace by mu2. So this is your thing. This is normally in the classroom also. So epsilon square, that is identity square is identity. Rho square is identity. Mu 1 square is identity. Mu 2 square is identity. Rho mu 1 is mu 2. Rho mu 2 is mu 1, like that. But in a classroom, we give an abstract. So symmetry R is generated by rho mu 1. Rho square is equal to mu 1 square is equal to identity. Rho mu 1 is equal to mu 1 rho is equal to mu 2. It is a abelian group. Why? Because the first row is first column. Second row is same as second column. Third row is same as the third column. The fourth row is same as the fourth column. Therefore, it's an abelian group. It is a Klein's 4 group. And Klein's 4 group is a non-cyclic abelian group of smallest order. But normally in a classroom, we give the Klein's 4 group as an abstract group like this. We give the Klein's 4 group in the class as EABC, A square is identity, B square is identity, C square is identity, AB is equal to C, BA is equal to C, like that, AC is equal to B, CA is equal to B, AB, and BC is equal to A, CB is equal to A. We'll give. This is the abstract Kallis table for the Klein's 4 group. So the Klein has discovered this group as the symmetric group of the rectangle R. That is the story behind the Klein's 4 group. Forget about it. Now this is the one. Now, in a classroom, normally we teach only this much and we will leave like that. But you know, we will now talk about how the subgroups of this Klein's 4 group will look like. Subgroup diagram of CIMR. Now, the identity alone is a trivial subgroup, and it is a subgroup of the group generated by rho, that is epsilon rho. And it is a subgroup of the whole group sim r. And the trivial group identity alone is a subgroup of the group generated by mu 1. Mu 1 square is identity. It's a subgroup of order 2. And it is a subgroup of the whole symmetry, whole Klein's 4 group. The epsilon, the identity alone is a subgroup of the group generated by mu 2, is a subgroup of order 2, which is a subgroup of the whole Klein's 4 group. Therefore, the subgroups of the symmetric group will look like this lattice. You can also see this subgroup, this subgroup, the join is the intersection, is the identity element alone. And this subgroup, this subgroup, the meet, not the join, it's the meet. And the join will give the whole of this thing. This is the subgroup diagram of symmetric group of R. If you teach this in a class, the students will not only see how many subgroups are there, how they are related also, you will get. These ideas are very important sometimes when we are solving some of the problems in competitive examinations. Yes. Now, change the story. The story is, you know, many times people ask the question, sir, what are the applications of the groups? Now, people will teach groups and we will write the exam, forget about it, and then we do not know what are the applications of groups. Symmetry, not necessarily the plane symmetry. In this example, in this lesson, I am teaching the plane symmetry, but actually in space also you have the space symmetry. That is a very important in chemistry, and the group theory is the tool that is used to determine the symmetry of the molecules. And here it is a demonstration. These are the mirror symmetries. Mirror symmetries means reflective symmetries. This is the rotational symmetry of a water molecule, H2O. And symmetric groups are used to describe crystals. And if you know the symmetric groups, you know the properties of that crystal. The space symmetric groups describe atomic structure of the crystals. And the point symmetric groups determine the crystal's external shape. And what we are talking about, the point symmetric groups, because this is the symmetric groups concerned to the plane and about the points only. And this will give you crystal's external shape. And very large groups of prime order are constructed in elliptic curve cryptography, which serve for public key cryptography. Cryptography and elliptic curve cryptography, public key cryptography is very important subjects today in mathematics, and a lot of research is going on, and the interested teachers can pursue these things. And those are the applications of groups. Okay, now hitherto we were talking about any plane figure. For that matter. But now we will concentrate on regular n-gons. And regular n-gons means regular polygons. Polygons with n sides. And you know, a regular three-gon is an equilateral triangle. We know. A regular four-gon is a square. Not a rectangle. It is a square. And a regular five-gon is a regular pentagon. And a regular six-gon is a regular hexagon. Yes. Now, why are we talking about? We want to talk about the symmetry groups of regular n-gons. The symmetry groups of the regular n-gons are nth dihedral groups. What are nth dihedral group? A nth dihedral group is the symmetry group of a regular n-gon. So, we will pursue that one. So, reflective symmetries of regular n-gons, we will consider in two cases. First one is when n is odd. The second is when n is even. The first case we'll go to the first case. Reflective symmetries of regular n-gons. Case one, when n is odd. When n is odd, we take an equilateral triangle. A regular trigon is an equilateral triangle. Now, I take this is the line of symmetry 1D, which is nothing but the midpoint of a side joining to its opposite vertex, which is none other than the median, and you know that will give you the symmetry. That will give you the symmetry. That means that there is a reflective symmetry with 1D as the axis of symmetry. There is the other 2E, the other median, and there is a reflective symmetry with 2E as the axis of symmetry, and 3F, and this is the animation. There is a reflective symmetry with 3F as the axis of symmetry. So thus, what is that we have got? We have got there are three axes of symmetry. Therefore, the corresponding to these three axes of symmetry, we will write down the corresponding permutations. So we will get the reflective symmetries of a trigon. So all reflective symmetries of a trigon, that is an equilateral triangle, are now found. Each axis of symmetry connects the midpoint of one side to the opposite vertex. Okay. Reflective symmetries of a regular pentagon. That means when n is odd, this is the discussion. This is the center of the pentagon, and this is the line of symmetry. What is this line of symmetry? The midpoint of a side connecting to the opposite vertex. Next, midpoint of this side connecting to the opposite vertex. Midpoint of this side connecting to the opposite vertex. Midpoint of this side connecting to the opposite vertex. So midpoint of this side connecting to the opposite vertex. That means we will get five lines of symmetries. The second one, the third one, the fourth one, the fifth one, because it is a pentagon, we get there are five axes of symmetry. Each axis of symmetry connects the midpoint of one side to the opposite vertex. This is same in the case of a regular trigon. We have three axes of symmetry, and each axis of symmetry connects to the midpoint of one side to the opposite vertex. In the case of pentagon, five axis of symmetry, and it is the same thing. So that means when n is odd, in the case of n-gons, in general, in the case of n-gon, if n is odd, there are n axes of symmetry, and each axis of symmetry connects the midpoint of one side to the opposite vertex. So therefore, we have found in general, for an n-gon, when n is odd, the axis of symmetries, n axis of symmetries, and line of symmetries are the lines connecting to the midpoint of one side to the opposite vertex. This is the when n is odd. When n is even, that is our discussion. When n is even, we take a square. So we have a square, and this is the 1, 2, 3, 4. And this is one line of symmetry connecting to the midpoints of the opposite sides. And there is the other one is connecting to the midpoints of opposite sides. And they will map like this. We have two axes of symmetry connecting midpoints of opposite sides. And the other one is the axis of symmetry is diagonal. That is 1, 3 diagonal. And there is the other one along the diagonal 2, 4. So we have two axes of symmetry connecting opposite vertices. So two axes of symmetry connecting the midpoints of the opposite sides, two axes of symmetry connecting opposite vertices. So in all, we have four lines of symmetry. So four lines of symmetry. In all, there are four acts of symmetry. Similarly, we'll also study the reflective symmetries of a hexagon. So here is an hexagon, one, connecting the midpoints of the opposite sides, two, three. So there are three. These are the connecting the midpoints of the opposites. There are three. There are three acts of symmetry connecting the midpoints of the opposite sides. The other ones? So three acts of symmetry connecting the opposite vertices. This. The other one is this. Is the other one is this. So there are three axes of symmetry connecting opposite vertices. So they are all here, one, two, three, four, five, six. So these are the, in all, there are six axes of symmetry. So there are, in the case of a regular N gun, there are N axes of symmetry, but half of them are, half of them have the axis of symmetry connecting the midpoints of opposite sides. Half of them will have the three axis of symmetry connecting the opposite vertices. So in general, the case of an N gun, if N is even, then there are N by 2 axis of symmetry connecting the opposite sides, connecting the midpoints of opposite sides, and N by 2 axis of symmetry connecting the opposite vertices. So in all, there are N axis of symmetry. So we have found all reflective symmetries of a regular N gun. What about rotational symmetries of a regular N guns? So there are, we need not consider two different cases. Rotational symmetries of a regular N gun are denoted by rho k alpha, where k will be 0, 1, 2, 3, up to 1, n minus 1. That means rho 0, rho 1, rho 2, rho 3, rho n minus 1, rho n is identity, where alpha e is 360 degrees by n. Rho alpha, rho 2 alpha, rho 3 alpha, rho n minus 1 alpha, rho n alpha will be identity. Alpha is equal to 360 degrees by n. A regular N gun has a cyclic rotation group of order N, and it is denoted by the cyclic group generated by rho, where rho is rho alpha. Now, there is an example. The example is a typical example we have given, and what is the order of rotational symmetry? This is the typical regular pentagon. So this is the, that was the original, this is the image, this is the reference point. So it is a regular N gun, N is equal to 5. Alpha is the angle of rotational symmetry, that is 360 degrees by N, 360 degrees by 5, that is equal to 72 degrees. Rho alpha, rotational symmetry corresponding to alpha. One time, yes, rho alpha, rho 2 alpha, rho 3 alpha, rho 4 alpha, rho 5 alpha, it coincides with the original and it is the identity. It is the identity. So rotational group is rho k alpha, k is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, that is rho naught, rho 1 alpha, rho 2 alpha, rho 3 alpha, rho 4 alpha. So it is this cyclic group generated by rho, where rho is rho alpha. It is a cyclic rotation group of order 5. And it is a subgroup of S5. Okay, now let us go to the dihedral group. What is the dihedral group defined? When n is equal to 3, 4, we define the nth dihedral group to be defined as the group of symmetries of a regular N gun. And it is denoted by dn. And its order is 2n. Why? A regular N gun has 2n different symmetries. What are they? N rotational symmetries, N reflection symmetries. So dn is generated by a rotation rho of order n and a reflection mu of order 2, such that rho mu is equal to mu rho inverse. Mu rho inverse. So dn is generated by rho mu. Rho power n is equal to mu square is equal to identity. Rho mu is equal to mu rho inverse. These are the defining relations of any general nth dihedral group. It is generated by rho, a rotation, and mu, a reflection. And the defining relations are these ones. Dihedral groups are among the simplest examples of finite groups, and they play an important role in group theory, geometry, and chemistry. And Dn is a proper subgroup of Sn for n greater than or equal to 4. It is giving you a clue. When n is equal to 3, D3 is same as S3. Now we will now compute dihedral group D3. So we have a regular trigon, and the group of symmetries of an equilateral triangle is the dihedral group D3. It's of order 6. We will find now D3. Now find D3. So rotational symmetries of an equilateral triangle, which we have already studied, but now I will write alpha is the angle of rotational symmetry. It is the smallest angle for which the figure can be rotated to coincide with itself. The formula is alpha is equal to 360 degrees by n. N is equal to 3. 360 degrees by 3, that is 120 degrees. That means you rotate the equilateral triangle, you know, about its center. The center is the centroid of the equilateral triangle, and through an angle 120 degrees in the clockwise direction. So rho alpha is rotational symmetry corresponding to alpha. Now let us see the rotation group of the equilateral triangle. This is the original equilateral triangle, and its image is this here with 0 degrees of rotation. This is the situation. So the with 0 degrees of rotation, the permutation is 1 goes to 1, 2 goes to 2, 3 goes to 3. Black 1 goes to blue. That is the rule. Now you have rotated through 120 degrees, that is rotated by alpha. Rho alpha is 1 mapping to 2, 2 mapping to 3, 3 mapping to 1. So this is the rho alpha. Rho 2 alpha, 240 degrees you have rotated, and you got rho 2 alpha. Rho 2 alpha will take you 1 to 3, 2 to 1, 3 to 2. And rho 3 alpha, that is 360 degrees, it comes to the original, and it will be rho naught, which is the identity. The rotation group is the set of all rotations, rho alpha, rho 2 alpha, rho 3 alpha. Rho 3 alpha is equal to rho naught, and it is the cyclic group generated by rho, where rho is rho alpha, rho square is rho 2 alpha, rho cube is equal to rho 3 alpha, and rho naught is equal to the identity. And it is a cyclic rotation group of order 3. Note, it is a proper subgroup of S3. Let's get into the reflective symmetries. Now, 1D, this is the axis of symmetry, which is the median. And reflective symmetry in 1D, reflection in 1D is equal to mu 1. 1 is fixed, 1 goes to 1. 2 is mapped to 3, 3 is mapped to 2. So reflection in 2E. So reflection in 2E is denoted by mu 2, and 2 is fixed, 2 goes to 2, and 1 is mapped to 3, 3 is mapped to 1 in this line of symmetry. And 3F. The reflection in 3F is mu 3, and for mu 3, 3 is fixed, 3 goes to 3, 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 1. 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 1, 3 is fixed. And these are the three reflections you got. Now we compute dihedral group D3. Rho is equal to rho alpha is equal to 1, 2, 3, 2, 3, 1. Rho cube is equal to identity. Rotational group is the cyclic group generated by rho. Mu is equal to mu 1. 1 is fixed, 2 and 3 are swapped. Mu square is equal to identity. Notice that mu is this, rho is this, multiply from right to left as I have explained you, and this is the outcome, is mu 2. and mu rho square again from multiply from right to left, and it is mu 3. So you got thus mu rho, that means take the cyclic group generated by rho and take its left coset by mu. That is mu rho, if you take the left coset, that will be mu times epsilon rho rho square, mu into identity mu, mu into rho, mu rho, mu rho square is mu rho square. And you know this mu rho, mu is mu 1, mu rho square are mu 2 and mu 3. So mu 1, mu 2, mu 3. That means the reflective symmetries are obtained by the left coset of the rotation group. Left coset of the rotation group by taking one mirror symmetry. That is the reflective symmetry. Mu is mu 1. So there's further rho mu is mu rho square. Rho mu is mu rho square, and this is same as mu rho inverse. Why? Rho cube is identity, rho square is rho inverse is rho square. So now dihedral group. Now D3, it is the group of symmetries of an equilateral triangle. It is the set of all rotational symmetries union the reflective symmetries, that is equal to the cyclic group generated by rho, and the reflective symmetries is mu 1, mu 2, mu 3. And the mu 1, mu 2, mu 3 is the left coset of the cyclic group generated by rho. And it is now generated by two elements, rho and mu. Rho cube is equal to identity. Mu square is equal to identity. Rho mu is equal to mu rho, rho square, same as mu rho inverse. So this is a D3. D3 is the group generated by rho mu. Rho cube is equal to mu square, is equal to the identity. Rho mu is equal to mu rho inverse. Rho inverse is same as rho square because rho cube is identity. Thus, the order of D3 is 6, and you know, it is a non-abelian group of smallest order. It is the first. It is the non-abelian group of smallest order. Why? Rho mu is not same as mu rho. So that is why it is a non-abelian group, and it is a non-abelian group of the smallest side. And let's now calculate the Callis table is here, and identity rho, rho square, mu, mu rho, mu rho square. These are the reflective symmetries, and rows are here, columns are here. And first row is very easy. Identity times of anything is identity. Therefore, you will get this. And if you multiply the first column with identity, you will get the same. First column is very easy, and this is also same. Right. Let's go move to the here, and first column, second column. I will write the second. First column we have already written. Second column is rho time identity rho square here, rho square, rho, rho cube, identity, mu rho, mu rho, mu rho, rho, mu rho square, rho, mu rho cube is mu. It's very easy. Now, again, the third column is again very easy, because identity, rho square, rho, rho square, rho cube, rho square, rho power 4, rho power 4, rho cube is identity, rho power 4 is rho, mu rho square is mu rho square, mu rho, rho square, mu rho cube is mu, mu rho square, mu rho power 4 is mu rho. So you'll get these things. It's very easy. Now you observe this, again, the rotations are in 1 3x3 grid, and reflections are in the other 3x3 grid. Right. So we will now compute the second row, which are kept like stars, star, double star, triple star. And what are the properties? Rho cube is equal to mu square is equal to identity, and rho mu is equal to mu rho square. This is very important, very important. Now you have to compute rho square into mu, rho square into mu, compute rho square into mu, oh, sorry. Rho into mu. This star is rho into mu. Rho into mu is mu rho square. So right here mu rho square. And rho into mu rho. Rho into mu rho is equal to rho mu rho, associative law you have used. Rho mu is equal to mu rho square. Mu rho square rho. Mu rho cube. That is equal to mu, because rho cube is the identity. So here it is mu. The three stars. Rho mu rho square. Rho mu rho square is equal to associativity. Rho mu into rho square. Rho mu is mu rho square. Mu rho square into rho square. Rho square into rho square. Rho power 4. Rho power 4 is rho only, because rho cube is identity. And you will get mu rho. So therefore, here it is mu rho square. Here it is mu. Here it is mu rho. So this is what I have. The next, the third P. So now we want to calculate these things. What is this? Rho square into mu. First, rho square into mu. So rho square into mu. Rho into rho mu. Associativity. Now, rho into rho mu is mu rho square. That is equal to rho mu into rho square, associativity. Rho mu is mu rho square. Mu rho square into rho square. Mu rho power 4, that is equal to mu rho. So it is mu rho. Next, what is here? Double star. Rho square into mu rho. Rho square into mu rho. Now, use associativity. Rho square mu into rho. And rho square mu. Rho square mu, which is equal to mu rho, which we have already calculated. Rho square mu, mu rho, you can write mu rho into rho, mu rho square. And this is mu rho square. Now, rho square into mu rho square. So associativity, rho square mu. And rho square mu is mu rho. So you write mu rho, rho square. Mu rho, rho square, mu rho cube is identity, mu. It is mu. So therefore, the first is mu rho, and this is mu rho square. This is mu. So, got it. Now observe this. This grid is again 3x3 grid is again, reflective symmetries. Same color I have used. And the fourth row is easy to compute. Why? Mu square is identity. Mu rho, that is mu square rho. That is mu square is identity, it's rho. And mu rho square, mu square rho square. Mu square is identity, it is rho square. So therefore, it is identity rho, rho square. Fifth row. So you calculate mu rho into mu. So associativity, mu rho, mu into rho mu. Mu times mu rho mu is mu rho square. That is mu square rho square. Mu square is identity rho square. So here we got rho square. So now again, mu rho into mu rho. Now you apply mu rho associativity. For this mu rho mu, use mu rho mu, that is rho square. It will reduce your steps. Rho square into rho, that's rho cube is equal to identity. Again, it is mu rho into mu rho square. Mu rho into mu rho square. Now again, you use mu rho. Mu rho into mu rho, the previous one you use, mu rho into mu rho, is epsilon identity rho, that is equal to rho. So this is how you will use the defining relations. Here it is rho square, here it is identity, here it is rho. So like that, you will be going on doing even the sixth row also. We will fill up the sixth row also in a similar manner. And you will get these answers. So that is the sixth partial row is rho square identity. Again, we will observe this 3x3 grid is the corresponding to rotations. This 3x3 grids corresponds to reflective symmetries. So now, Callis table is this. What is this? D3 is generated by two generators, rho mu. Rho cube is equal to mu square is equal to identity. Rho mu is equal to mu rho inverse. And it is actually same as S3, not isomorphic to S3. It is same as S3. Again, I will now talk about the Kallis table for D3. And I will see some of the subgroups. And D3 is generated by epsilon, rho, rho square, mu 1, mu 2, mu 3. And D3 has one proper subgroup of order 3, that is the rho the cyclic group generated by rho, that is epsilon, rho, rho square, is of order 3. And three subgroups of order 2, epsilon, mu 1, because mu 1 square is identity, epsilon, mu 2, epsilon, mu 3. So these are the subgroups. Let us see the subgroup structure. The subgroup structure is this. Epsilon rho, rho square, epsilon is a subgroup of epsilon mu 1, and it's a subgroup of this trivial group, subgroup of this, subgroup of the original. So this is subgroup of this one, the subgroup of this one. Now you see, you must have a clear-cut idea, even S3 or D3, whatever it is. There are three different subgroups of order 2, one subgroup of order 3, and of course, trivial subgroups are there, D3 and the identity element alone. This is the subgroup diagram of D3. And we will move to D4. And what is the time? 12 o'clock. Satyaya, please respond. How much time is left? Hello, Jyoti, tell me.
Sir.
How much time?
12:06, sir.
12:06, all right, you know. Shall we rewind? Shall we close down the lecture or finish off this? It will take 10 more minutes.
Okay, sir. 5 to 10 minutes, you can do negotiation.
Okay. So we talk about the dihedral group D4. A regular foregon is a square. The group of symmetries of a square is the dihedral group D4, and it's of order 8. We now find D4. So let's take rotational symmetries of a square. Now, alpha, the angle of rotational symmetry, that is the smallest angle for which the figure can be rotated to coincide with itself, that is 360 degrees by 4, that is 90 degrees. Rho alpha is the rotational symmetry corresponding to alpha. So we calculate rotation group of a square. So this is the original, no rotation. It is rotated through 0 degrees, and that is rho naught, that is the permutation corresponding to, here is a mistake, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now rotated through 90 degrees, rho alpha, and how it has taken? 1, 2, 3, 4 will map to 2, 3, 4, 1. 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, 4 to 1. Rotate by 2 alpha, that is 180 degrees. And 1 is mapped to 3, 2 is mapped to 4, 3 is mapped to 1, 4 is mapped to 2. 3 alpha, 270 degrees. And the corresponding permutation is here. Rho 4 alpha, that is 360 degrees. It comes to the original position, that is the identity. Therefore, the rotation group is this. So rho alpha, rho 2 alpha, rho 3 alpha, rho 4 alpha, that is identity. Where rho is equal to rho alpha, rho square is rho 2 alpha, rho cube is rho 3 alpha, rho 4 alpha is equal to identity. It is a cyclic rotation group of order 4. It is a proper subgroup of S4. And let's talk about reflective symmetries of a square. There will be again 4. This is one axis of symmetry. And corresponding to this, XY, one map to 4. 4 map to 1, 2 map to 3, 3 map to 1 to 4, 2 to 3, 3 to 2, 4 to 1. So 1 and 4 are swapped, 2 and 3 are swapped. And corresponding to PQ, this is the other line of symmetry. And you will get a reflection. You will get mu, 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 1, 1 and 2 are swapped, 3 and 4 are swapped. And along the diagonal, and we will get mu 3. Mu 3 is 1 and 3 are fixed, 4 and 2 and 4 are swapped. The other one, and 2 and 4 are fixed, 2 and 4 are fixed, 1 and 3 are swapped. So thus we got 4 reflective symmetries of a square, and 2 of them corresponds to the sides and 2 of them corresponds to the diagonals. Now the diagonal group D4 is given by rho is equal to rho alpha, rho power 4 is identity. The rotation group is given by this, and mu is equal to mu 1, mu square is equal to identity. Mu rho, calculate, compute, and multiply them from right to left. And mu 4, mu rho is mu 4, mu rho square is mu square, mu rho cube is mu 3. So that means the left coset of rho by mu will give all the reflective symmetries. So thus, mu rho, mu cyclic group generated by rho, left coset of the cyclic group generated by rho, that will be equal to mu times epsilon rho, rho square, rho cube, mu rho, mu rho square, mu rho cube. They are mu 1, mu 2, mu 3, mu 4. Thus, and you want this rho mu also. Why? Because we have to give the defining relations there. And mu rho cube, rho mu is mu rho cube. Mu rho cube is same as mu rho power minus 1. And mu rho cube is not equal to mu rho. Rho mu is not equal to mu rho. Therefore, this D4 is going to be a non-abelian group of order 8. Now let us see the dihedral group. The dihedral group D4 is taken. So the set of rotational symmetries union the reflective symmetries, and you will get the cyclic group generated by rho union mu rho. It is generated by rho mu. Rho cube is equal to mu square is equal to identity. Rho mu is equal to mu rho inverse, that is rho cube. So D4 is generated by rho mu. Rho cube is equal to mu square is equal to identity. Rho mu is equal to mu rho cube is same as mu rho inverse in this case. The order of D4 is 4 times 2, that is 8, and it is non-abelian because rho mu is not equal to mu rho. And we write the Callis table very quickly. First row, easy. First column, easy. Second column, easy. Third column, easy. The fourth column, easy. So this is the situation. Observe that. This is the thing. And this is the 4x4 grid corresponding to rotations. This is the 4x4 grid corresponding to rotations. And you have to fill these things keeping stars. So like that. So we will have two partial stars here. Stars here. And I will show you one. Rho mu is mu rho cube. Here it will come rho mu. So rho into mu rho. Rho into mu rho is equal to rho mu rho. Rho mu is mu rho cube. Rho. Mu rho power 4. That is mu. So here you will get mu. And rho mu rho. So rho mu rho square. Rho mu is mu rho cube. Rho mu is mu rho cube. And that will be mu rho. And rho times mu rho cube. Rho mu, rho cube. Rho mu is mu rho cube, rho cube. Mu rho power 6 is mu rho square. So here it is mu rho cube, here it is mu, here it is mu rho, here it is mu rho square. So got it. So like that, the third row also will be computed, and we'll also do the fourth row also. We will do that. And you'll get these things. And now, again, this 4x4 grid corresponds to reflections. And like that, we will be calculating all these things. And this is rho cube epsilon identity rho rho square. Again, we'll also do like that. Calculate them, and it will be filled with rho square, rho cube, identity rho. The last rho will be computed. So mu rho cube into mu. Mu rho cube into rho, that is equal to rho cube mu. Mu rho cube. Mu rho cube into mu. Mu into rho cube mu. Rho cube mu is mu rho, mu square rho. So like that, we will calculate all of them. We'll calculate all of them, and you will get this one. And again, you observe. Again, you observe this 4x4 grid corresponds to rotations. 4x4 grid corresponds to rotations, and these 4x4 grids corresponds to reflections. And this is your defining relation. D4 is a non-abelian group of order 8, and it is called octic group. Let's see the cyclic, that subgroup structure. It has a trivial H0 identity element alone, H1 epsilon mu 1, the cyclic group generated by mu 1, cyclic group generated by mu 2, subgroup group generated by mu 3, cyclic group mu 3. So H3 is cyclic group generated by rho square. These are all cyclic groups of order 2. H5 and is also cyclic group of order 2, H5. H6, this has four elements. It's actually a Klein's 4 group. H7, another, is a cyclic group generated by rho, not H8, it is Klein's 4 group. Now, H1 to H5, they are cyclic group subgroups, cyclic subgroups of order 2. H6 and H8 are Klein's 4 groups. H7 is a cyclic subgroup of order 4 generated by rho. And the subgroup structure is this one. Subgroup of it. Subgroup of this. Subgroup of H3. Subgroup of H4, subgroup of H5. H1 is a subgroup of H6. H2 is a subgroup of H6. H3 is a subgroup of H6. H3 is a subgroup of H8. H4, subgroup of H8. H5, subgroup of H8. H3, subgroup of H7. H7 is a subgroup of the whole group D4. H6 is a subgroup of D4. And H8 is a subgroup of D4. And normally, in many of the textbooks, sometimes the cover pages will be like this. And one of my students asked me, "Sir, what is this diagram it talks about?" And at that time, I have explained so many things like this. But you know, it is now when a time has come, I want to tell you to all the teachers and the students, this is the subgroup diagram. The subgroup structure will be very, very helpful. So that is the story of the Klein's 4 group, which is the group of symmetries of a rectangle, and the group of symmetries of the regular N-gons is the nth dihedral group denoted by D suffix N, and it's of order 2N. And I have told you how the SIMR, that is symmetries, the symmetry groups of the rectangle R, which is the Klein's 4 group, and D3, the dihedral group corresponding to the equilateral triangle is precisely S3, and D4 is an octet group, which will be looking like that, and their subgroup structures I have told you. This is what I wanted to tell you. So this is the story of the dihedral groups. I hope that all the students and the teachers might have understood this lecture. And particularly this lecture is very, very lucid and written for the student's sake. And it is an illustrative lecture. because all illustrations I have given, I did not leave anything. And at the time of D4 also, I have computed one or two there. And the remaining things are homework, because we have already computed at D3. I have computed the whole of them. And how to calculate or compute Cayley's tables is like this. So this is the story of D4. I thank Satyaya and his group for conducting for such a nice guest lecture. I thank the college management for giving me this opportunity to deliver this talk. I hope that you have understood, and we will meet again on some other occasion with some other title. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. It was a wonderful session. We will go ahead and take some time for questions now. Just a reminder, students, please be sure to type your questions into the chat box in your control panel. I think there seems to be no questions.
Okay. Any questions from teachers? Questions from teachers?
No, sir. No, from faculty side also. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Somebody is asking, sir, screen is not visible. Something like
no,
that?
No, sir. No problem. Screen visible already. Okay.
Thank you, sir. It is a super presentation. I think you have spent hours of time to prepare such beautiful presentation. Thank you very much. Satyanarayana A was telling that it is a good presentation. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
So thank you. I leave.
Okay, sir. Madam. Sir, 2 minutes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. May I now invite Ms. Nehalata to propose a vote of thanks.
Good afternoon, one and all. I am Snehalata. I am here to present the vote of thanks for today's guest lecture. I would like to thank you, our guest lecturer, Professor K. Satyanarayana, for accepting our request and enlightening us with their knowledge. Today's guest lecture was full of knowledge and interesting things. Sir, explain us about the dihedral groups, types of symmetries, plane symmetry, reflective symmetry, rotational symmetry, specialty of Klein's four group, subgroups of symmetric groups, Cayley's table, applications of groups, regular n-gons, subgroup structures was really informative. And also, sir, explain about difference between symmetric and symmetry. We definitely explain about these in our classroom, sir. The way of PPT presentation is also very nice, sir. I'm pretty sure the precious knowledge that he gave us, which definitely help us in our studies and future. Thank you so much, sir. I thank the management of AV College, our secretary, Professor G. Prakash Reddy, sir, correspondent, Dr. K. Gautami, ma'am. I also extend my sincere gratitude to the principal, Dr. C. H. Rajalingam, sir, our vice principal, Dr. Padma, ma'am, academic coordinator for physical and life sciences, Ms. Manjula Devi, ma'am, and all other heads of the department and staff. And also thank you to all the students present here for paying your attention and learning. And also special thanks to the technical department, Sushil sir and team. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you all.